About nationalism and how it kind of started and how everybody was all proud to be American and then they weren't as proud to be American. So that's what we're talking about today. Let's get started. Because of the War of 1812, we're seeing a rise in manufacturing, but after the war there's major chaos between banking and shipping because the Bank of the United States, their charter ran out. So what happened, state banks started to become more popular, we're seeing them rise, but they're already starting to make their own money. So they're making their own currency, and it all has its own different values. So if you have currencies with different values, you could just be like, oh yeah, this is Maryland's money. It's worth this much, and it's real. People didn't understand. They just assumed, okay, I guess we can just accept this, but there's major counterfeiting going on, and rightfully so. You can understand why. So there's chaos with that. So in 1816, Congress passed a second charter for the Bank of the United States to last for another 20 years. We're going to see that's going to cut off, though, later. So why was manufacturing so important? Well, because of the embargo of 1807 and because of the war, a lot of things had to be done here. So it just kind of rose from that. And one of the major factories was created by Francis Lowell outside of Boston in 1813. Guess what he did? He put the process of spinning and weaving together. What? Can't believe he did something like that. And then eventually we're going to see the English are like, now that we're friends with them again, why don't we sell our stuff there for cheaper than what the Americans are charging? But Congress is like, no, we're going to put a tariff on that so that their stuff isn't as cheap as the infant industries. We don't want them to fall by the wayside in the United States. New Englanders in the north, the manufacturers are like, yeah, we're happy about that. But farmers in the south are like, excuse me, I don't like this, because now they have to pay higher prices for goods and services. With the farmers growing a lot of crops and the manufacturing making a lot of stuff, they don't just keep it for themselves. They need to sell it to others. And how do they do that? Well, they need to transport it somehow to the rest of the country or overseas. So we saw a major push for transportation. And the big question of the day was, should the federal government pay for this? Well, some people said yes, some people said no. In 1807, Jefferson Secretary of State Albert Gallatin, he proposed that all the money that they gained from selling land in Ohio could be pushed towards building a national road. And there were some roads being built. The Lancaster Pike in Pennsylvania was built, meaning like a turnpike. It allowed for transportations to be sent back and forth along the way. The steamboat that was perfected by Robert Fulton, that helped move things in the Great Lakes and along the Mississippi. So those in the West and the South, that helped them move their stuff. But that still wasn't enough. But Madison refused. John C. Calhoun's like, hey, why don't we use federal funds to pay for internal improvements, infrastructure, road, transport, stuff like that. And Madison, at the time, a little guy said, no, I just feel like that's unconstitutional. So he refused to pass it because he was a strict constitutionalist, James Madison was. So when it came to transportation at the time, there were turnpikes. There was some steam boats moving things, but it still wasn't enough. And the only people who were really funding it were private entrepreneurs or the state governments, not the federal government. Right now, we're going to learn about how we're moving out west. Now, why do we want to move out west? Well, after the War of 1812, we see a big influx of the population. People are seeing there's not enough room in the east, and I want me some of this land, so I'm moving out west, where I see that on the Great Lakes and the Grand Mississippi, there's lots of opportunities, so I'm going out there. Now, however, we are going to see some consequences of this. Yes, we see the population increase. Yes, we see a good influx in the economy. We're seeing it grow. But we're going to also see that some of these factors of people moving west are actually going to lead to the Civil War. This is one of the major causes of the Civil War. But we will, of course, talk about that at a later date. So what was like life in the old Northwest when they're moving out west? Our West is what we call today the Midwest, where we're looking at Illinois and Indiana and Kentucky, all those places. Well, shelters were pretty primitive. They, you know, when you think of a log cabin, that's, you know, luxury living when we're seeing what was going on out there. But what did they have to do? There's a lot of forest, so they had to clear it to gain crops and be able to grow crops, but there's a lot of game and domestic animals around that they could use and eat, obviously. But it was pretty rough because it was a life of poverty and it was a life of loneliness. But when we see the migrants going out there, when they journey westward, they're usually going to go in big groups. It just seems that mobility in these large groups is what's going to help them sustain when they move out west. What was their economy like out there? Well, it was an agrarian economy. It was, we're not seeing the big plantations we would see out east, but they were pretty much modest farms. And what would they grow? Grains, and they would also raise livestock. We're also seeing growth in the Southwest, which is like Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, during this time period. We're seeing this because the soil, what they call the Black Belt in this area, was nutrient rich and can grow like the long cotton that was really hard to grow at the time, but it could grow well there. So with that came farmers, and these farmers were able to build these massive plantations when they're bringing slaves. So we are seeing the spread of slavery during this time period. But because of these massive population growths in the Northwest, which is now the Midwest, and the Southwest, which is part of the South that we know today, we see different states being created like Indiana, Mississippi, Illinois, and Alabama, respectively. In the very far West, we are starting to see trade develop between the Western regions and the U.S. and beyond. Now, at the time, Mexico controlled a lot of this area, including what is now Texas, California, and much of the present-day Southwest, because they had won their independence from Spain in 1821, so it was Mexico controlling this. Now, there were U.S. merchants that actually went out there and tried to create entrepreneurships there, including William Becknell, who displaced Indian traders and inferior Mexican traders by making his own trading company, and it actually superseded that of the Mexican trading company in its own country. We're also seeing fur traders like Jacob Astor's American Fur Company start out in the West. We're also seeing the Rocky Mountain Fur Company start out in the West. And now we're seeing that the white men are becoming trappers and not needing the Indians to trade fur with anymore. So there's just another way that the Indians are getting shoved aside. But these trappers really did rely on others for their livelihood because they had to rely on fur companies to get credit, but they also had to rely on the East to buy from them. What did people in the East think of the West? Really nothing. People pretty much did not know what was going on out there. And even when the U.S. government sent people out there, like Stephen Long in early 1800s, to find out what was going on in the West, he basically came back a report that said, there's really not anything we can do out there when it comes to development. We're starting to see the end of the first party system. The Federalists versus the Democratic Republicans are coming to an end. Why? Because after the War of 1812, most people really didn't want any type of partisan factions. They were sick of it. Things weren't going, you know, things were okay with the rest of the world. The Federalists had pretty much declined. So we're just really starting to see not any political parties. So who runs for president in 1816? That would be James Monroe. And he does become president with really no opposition, gets reelected in 1820 with no really opposition. So who does he put on his cabinet? He puts people from all over the country to kind of make it, this is all known as the era of good feelings, because there is no partisanship, nothing bad going on. Everybody's pretty much getting along, especially since he has his rainbow sunshine style of cabinet, which includes everybody from all over the country. One of our greatest Secretary of States of all time would be John Quincy Adams. He was the Secretary of State of James Monroe and soon will become President of the United States. But let's focus on him being Secretary of State first. Well, he was a committed nationalist and he was all about expanding our country. He was all for it. So who did he try to go after first? We wanted to go after Florida. We already controlled Western Florida, basically the panhandle. And in 1817 began negotiations with the Spanish minister of Florida. That would be Luis de Onís. And meanwhile, at the same time, we're fighting the Seminole War in Florida. This is Andrew Jackson leading the Americans. Secretary of War at the time, John C. Calhoun, said, go invade Florida, stop those Seminole raids. And he did. And And by doing that, this was Adam's way of saying, hey, we stopped these guys. You guys really don't have a chance against us. Spain, please let us annex Florida. So in 1819, I'm saying that backwards, the Adams-Onis Treaty was signed, which basically said that Florida could be ours and all the lands that were north of the 42nd parallel would be ours. And then we're like, we just won't try to go after Texas. Right. In 1819, we're going to see our first major panic. What exactly is a panic? Well, we call them depressions today. Why did we change the name? Because panic made people panic. That word just kind of freaks people out. So using the word depression kind of calmed them out a little bit. So what exactly happened? Well, this is just economics 101. There's always boom and bust period where we see things go up and things go down. It's a business cycle. And we had a high period of high foreign demand for our goods. Prices were rising, which helped stimulate the land boom in the western states. Western meaning the Midwest, what is known as the Midwest today, and then the Southwest, like in Alabama, Mississippi. But here's the thing. Availability for easy credit for the farmers was just from everywhere, not only from the government, but from state banks and wildcat banks, which are just, you know, local private banks. But in 1819, all of a sudden, the United States, the second bank of the United States, tightened credit and wouldn't allow banks to lend out as much money, and that caused banks to fail, and then farmers were losing their land because they couldn't afford to pay back their loans. So this was a major issue, and of course the farmers and those especially in the West were blaming the Bank of the United States for this, for tightening the credit. The Depression, this panic, lasted for 6 years. There was growth during the time, but it did last for a while. If you remember the title of this chapter, it's Varieties of American Nationalism. Well, the idea of nationalism is the idea of you putting your country first. Sectionalism is the idea of you putting your state or area first. And this is when we're starting to see sectionalism with the admission of Missouri as a state. Now, we were trying to figure out what to do. A lot of slaves have already been established there, but we really didn't know what to do. Even like there are some representatives like New York Representative Talmadge, who basically said, why don't we have gradual emancipation? It was super controversial because this is the first time we're seeing the talks of emancipation of the slaves. Well, since the beginning of the Union, it's always been an even balance. There's always one state from the North and one state from the South pretty much being admitted at the same time. So it's easy to have a free state and a slave state. Well, right now, Missouri's a little nervous. We're like, well, what do we do? Because we don't want if we make Missouri a slave state, the South has more power over the North and vice versa. Well, Maine at the time was applying for statehood, and Henry Clay threatened the South to block entrance into Missouri if they wanted to permit it as a slave state. So they made the Missouri Compromise and basically said this, three things. Number one, Maine would become a free state. Number two, Missouri would become a slave state, so we even out the balance. And number three, the line at the 36-30th parallel would not be allowed. Anything north of that would not be allowed to have slavery once they started to expand out west. During this time period, we're also seeing the Marshall Court. This is John Marshall. He was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court from 1801 to 1835. And he did several things during his tenure of office, including basically number one, strengthening the judicial branch over the executive and the legislative branch, and also strengthening these national powers over state powers. And here's a couple ways he did this. Number one, with Fletcher versus Peck in 1810, he said that Georgia legislatures could not repeal contracts that were created by previous legislatures. So he told states what they could do. In Dartmouth College versus Woodward, he affirmed the constitutionality of federal decisions over state courts. It's like, listen, you as a state gave up some of your rights when you signed the Constitution. Therefore, they have the right to, federal law has the right to decide on state decisions. The two really important cases besides Marbury versus Madison, which established judicial review, would be McCulloch versus Maryland and Gibbons versus Ogden. McCulloch versus Maryland was an implied powers type of case. It was the idea where the national government can do things they feel are necessary and proper for the country. So because of that, that meant that they had the power to destroy taxes, and that when the State Bank of Maryland was trying to tax the Bank of the United States and not use them, they said that was unconstitutional. So that gave more power to the national government because it enforced the idea that they could use implied powers, which means powers that aren't necessarily written word for word, but are implied in the Constitution. Also, Gibbons versus Ogden, this is interstate commerce, interstate trade between the states. This is where the government, with John Marshall, said, yes, they can and should and will control trade between states. And when they say commerce, he pretty much extends it to mean pretty all economic activity that goes on between states. So the decisions established many things: the primacy of the federal government over the states, regulation of the economy, and protecting corporations and private economic institutions from local governments. When it came to dealing with the Native Americans at the time, Marshall basically laid out the plan that the federal government was the one that had the right to control and decide upon the lands of Indians at the time, not private citizens. Those decisions were made in the court cases like Johnson versus McIntosh and Worcester versus Georgia in 1825 and 1832, respectively. So basically what John Marshall did at the time was something that the Constitution had not done, which is establish a place for the Indians in this country and to show that the government would be a guardian over its ward, which would be, as they think, the Indians. They felt they were a guardian for them. During this time period, there is a major shift in our diplomatic policy. We are seeing us have better relationship with Latin America because at first our total foreign policy focused clearly on Europe. But now that Europe's hold over the New World was kind of weakening, especially that of Spain, we start developing trade with Latin America. We take advantage of this, and this kind of threatens Great Britain and it threatens Spain. It threatens Great Britain for the trade and it threatens Spain because we are recognizing five new nations in Latin America that used to be under Spanish control that have now declared independence. So there's a little bit of a fear that there might be an issue with Spain. So what do? We take a stance. John Quincy Adams, James Monroe's Secretary of State at the time, he writes for James Monroe what is now known as the Monroe Doctrine, one of our most famous, important pieces of diplomatic history. And what this document said was basically this: Europe, you stay there, you stay out of our business. This whole land over here, you are not allowed to even think about trying to colonize it. It's ours. Stay out of our business. We'll stay out of yours. Oh, and if you come over here and try to take any of this, we're not going to see it as a friendly thing. We're going to see it as hostile, and we will go after you. So why do we do this? Because we were afraid that Spain might come back and try to regain its colonies that it had lost with the help of the French. And we were afraid of Great Britain trying to take over Cuba, which is, of course, 90 miles off our southern coast now that we control Florida. So this is when we start pretty much officially taking the stance of isolationism that we're going to keep pretty much through up until World War I. It's 1824 and there's another presidential election. James Monroe has already served his 2 years, the precedent set by President Washington, and now there's a new open seat for the presidency. So we're seeing a lot of people run. We're seeing the Republicans throw their weight behind William Crawford, but we also see Republicans throw their weight behind John Quincy Adams, and we see Speaker of the House Henry Clay running, but we also see a new emergence of Andrew Jackson. He decides to run as well. Well, there's not, when it came to the actual election, there wasn't a majority of who got a There wasn't a candidate who got a majority of the electoral votes. Sorry about that. And what happened is when that happens, because of the 12th Amendment, if there's not a majority, it goes to the House of Representatives to get voted upon who will become President of the United States. Each state would get one vote in the House. Well, here's what happened. The final three candidates were Andrew Jackson, Henry Clay, John Quincy Adams. And what was done is that Henry Clay said, listen, I know you support my American system where we have the North manufacturing using the South's cotton and agriculture and going back and forth. And why don't I put my weight behind you and tell everybody to vote for you instead of me? And then we kind of pushed Jackson to the side. So that's what happened. And then when that happened and Adams won, Henry Clay became his Secretary of State. So the Democrats on the other side, Jackson's side, were furious. They thought that this was a corrupt bargain because Jackson received the most popular votes and electoral votes, but because those two kind of ganged up on him, he lost this election. So it was known as a corrupt bargain. John Quincy Adams, a brilliant politician, had a terrible presidency because that legacy haunted him throughout his entire presidency. Unfortunately for John Quincy Adams, his presidency didn't run too well, and there was a lot of reasons. He really just couldn't get anyone to get on his side. The country was very divided. I know we had that era of good feelings where everything was hunky-dory and everybody's getting along. That's over. We're seeing this revival of opposition. Well, here's some of the things that happened. He did have a nationalist program that was similar to Henry Clay's American system, where, like I said, you would have the North manufacturing, the South raw goods, and then trading back and forth with each other. But the Jacksonians in Congress blocked it, so his plan couldn't get through because of divided government. Southerners in Congress were also blocking delegates because they were trying to have this international conference called by Simon Bolivar of Venezuela, and they said nope because there's going to be black delegates there, so they refused to even try to sit down with black delegates. So that hurt our relationship with Latin America because of the race of Southerners. In Georgia, they're trying to get rid of the Creek and Cherokee Indians. They're trying to remove them. And here's what happens. Adams refused to sign this treaty to remove them from Georgia. But Georgia's governor is like, I'm not listening to this guy. He's a kook, so I'm still removing them. So we are seeing even governors defying the president. So you know that they have really no respect for this guy. Here's the thing that was kind of like the nail in the coffin for John Quincy Adams. He supported this tariff on imported goods because he's like, listen, if you put a tariff on stuff from over in Europe, it'll make it more expensive, and then people want to buy more American stuff. So it would help New England's textile manufacturers because people would want to buy their stuff rather than buying the European stuff. Well, he, at the same time, to make the people in the West and the South happy, he put some concessions to them, and it just ticked everybody else. When you appease to everybody, it usually makes everybody mad, and everybody did get mad once it signed it, and they called this thing the Tariff of Abominations. The South was so angry about this that even some of them, including their leader behind this, John C. Calhoun, started to threaten secession. Now we come to the election of 1828. It's Andrew Jackson again, who is part of what they call the Democratic Republicans, is what we saw with Jefferson, and then we see the National Republicans who supported John Quincy Adams. And we're seeing that they want economic nationalism. The Democratic Republicans and Andrew Jackson want to assault the privilege and give opportunity to everybody. And that's how Jackson's going to win. This is the Jacksonian democracy where we start seeing he saying, let's have the common man be a part of it. I'm one of you guys. You're one of me. Let's get together and have opportunity for all. So you're going to see a lot of people liking this, and we're seeing more, instead of the elite running the show, the common man. Well, the campaign, this is one of the dirtiest campaigns in political history. They're going back and forth against each other. The National Republicans that were supported by John Quincy Adams, that supported John Quincy Adams, were like doing personal attacks against Jackson's wife to the point where it stressed her out so bad that she died from it. And of course, Jackson blamed the opponents. They were also making posters where they showed Jackson as a donkey. Instead of calling him Andrew Jackson, they called him Andrew Jackass. And actually, that's where the donkey, and for the Democrats, that's how they got their symbol, because Jackson thought it was actually really funny. So he kept that as the Democrat symbol, because yes, he is technically the Democratic Republicans right now, but this is going to be the emergence of the Democratic Party, the one we still see today. So he did win decisively, but it was a sectional victory. It's not like we see it like all over the place. It's like, listen, the New England area, the Mid-Atlantic, they were all for John Quincy Adams. The rest of the country, the South and the West, were more for Jackson. So we're starting to see sectionalism emerge rather than nationalism. USA, USA. Now it's like South, South, North, North. Okay? So that's it. Hope you have a nice night. Torch out.